Good morning.
My name is Isaac Julius from Resplod International. Thank you for joining today. Thank you for your time today. And we are here to treat investments in environmental sustainability for corporations, series one. This is the beginning of the series. The course promises a lot of benefits, and we'll have proper understanding on sustainability. There are various kinds of sustainability concepts, but for the course that we'll be taking now, we are going to focus on environmental sustainability. We will be defining sustainability and be looking into sustainability in the environmental context. First of all, we'd like to define sustainability. Sustainability is the ability to exist consistently in the 21st century. That is, we are defining in our own context now. It refers generally to the capacity for the biosphere and human civilization to coexist. And it is also defined as the process of people maintaining change in homeostasis, in homeostatic balance, in environment, and in which the exploitation of resources, the direction of investment, the orientation of technology and development and institutional change are all in harmony and enhances both current and future potentials of the human needs and aspiration. Sustainability in a nutshell is the ability to enjoy a progressive, consistent change without jeopardizing the future environment. And sustainable development is the organization, is the organizing principles for maintaining human development goals while simultaneously sustaining the ability of nature, of natural systems to provide the natural resource and ecosystem and ecosystem services based upon which the economy and safety depends. We have various pillars of sustainability. Basically, there are three, or you can say four: the economic sustainability, the environmental sustainability, the social sustainability, and technical sustainability. We will be looking at the technical sustainability. The technical sustainability is the design of a proposed project that is tailored with the technologies and facilitate simple operation and maintenance. Also, a proposed project is sustainable in view of proven technologies and strict adherence to international and national acceptable engineering practices. For projects to be sustainable, they have to they have to have a kind of flexibility because of the fast-paced, fast-changing world we are into, where development and automation and everything is all happening, and we have our best available technologies. The technical sustainability of a project depends largely on the ability of that technology to adapt to change, to adapt to automation, to adapt to automation, and then to adapt to AI, the artificial intelligence. Now, for every development project that has to be technically sustainable, it must build in itself the capacity to sustain and maintain these changes. Economic sustainability, when we talk about economic sustainability, is the ability of a project to sustain itself economically through its project lifespan. Through proper feasibility studies, investors will have considered the current and future demands of a product. For instance, if you are siting a solar power plant, you have to look for at the current demand for energy. And then if the lifespan of the project is going to be, let's say, for instance, the lifespan of the project is 25 years, then from 25 years before the commissioning of the project, the investor has to look into the future and see if this project is still going to be viable 25 years time. So this is economic sustainability, to see if there will be demands for these services or products that the facility will be supplying. Another part we are going to look at is the social sustainability. Now, in the social sustainability, we can look in the environmental and the World Bank environmental and social standards. We see that PS1 talks about the assessment and management of environmental and social risk and impact. PS3 talks about resource efficiency and pollution prevention. And then we look at PS4, ESS4, that's environmental and social standards 4, that talks about the community health and safety. This is where the foundation of the social sustainability is laid upon. The newly added ESS 10, which is stakeholders engagement and information disclosure, the ESS 8, which is the cultural heritage, and then the ESS 7, which centers on the indigenous people of the sub-Saharan Africa. Now, these are the bedrocks upon which the social sustainability lies. With proper consideration of these environmental and social standards, the project can be said to be viable and sustainable throughout its timeline. Now, we look at the environmental sustainability. When we talk about the environmental sustainability of a project, we talk about the environmental performance of the project. That is, the environmental performance means the environmental practices. Right now, what is being maintained, what is available at the environment in comparison with the World Bank environmental and social standards, and also for the Nigerian Federal Ministry of Environment, the standards. That is how we measure environmental performance. Now, in the implementation, the environmental sustainability of the projects largely depend for projects which have undergone the environmental and social impact assessment. The sustainability largely depends on the implementation of the environmental and social management plan that ensure that the project meets or exceeds all the requirements, that the basic requirement, which is the Nigerian Federal Ministry of Environment, and then the World Bank IFC standard and performance and environmental and social standards. That is how it is being measured. And then for the environmental sustainability, we see that the World Bank environmental and social standards centers on it largely, that we have the 10 environmental and social performance and social standards, which is the assessment and management of environmental and social risks and impacts, the labor and working condition, the resource efficiency and the pollution prevention management, the community health and safety, the land acquisition, which is the environmental and social safeguards, social standards, ESS 5, the land acquisition, which deals with the be ensured through various impact minimization and mitigation and monitoring to ensure which are integral parts of the project design. The environmental sustainability is like the lifeline of the project itself. Shortly, we'll be looking at the benefits of investments in environmental. Investors' integrity. For a facility that operates and maintains its environment and upgrades the environmental standard, we see that such companies, such organizations have their integrity in place. Because once a project is mentioned, the immediate environment are going to interpret the name of that project by the integrity of the proponent, of the project operator. And so many, for so many operators, they care so much about their integrity, not just about completing an environmental impact assessment and obtaining certificates and obtaining approvals, but no, they look into even how they maintain their own integrity. And then project lifespan fulfillment is another benefit that can be derived from investment in the management of environment, prolong the lifespan of a project. We see that so many projects have been truncated because maybe the social pillar was not well managed, the facility is operating, and the host communities are not happy with the facility, and they set up, they gang up and team up together because of lack of stakeholders' engagement and communication has not been proper. And then they team up together and come up with ideas and come to attack the project. And there are so many investors that have lost 100%, almost 100% of their investment due to social attacks, because the social pillar of the sustainability have not been properly managed. So by managing effectively the environmental and social aspect of a project, by managing effectively the environmental and social aspect of the project, the investor starts to enjoy the lifespan of the project. The project will definitely fulfill its lifespan. And then minimization of accidents and risks, that is, the accidents and risks occurs less in a facility where the environment is properly managed. Like for a mining site, for instance, depending on the kind of mining, if the environment is properly managed in the mine site, there are no downtimes and facility, there is more high minimization of risks of accidents and so many other things. Because part of environmental management is the signages, the safety signs, and the warning, the alarms, and the rest of that. And even the investments can be protected by some of these signages and some of these alarms, like the fire alarm, for instance, is still part of the environmental and social standard to have. Then legal and litigation benefits. When a project operates in compliance with environmental management and the environmental and social standards, they have no litigation issues to worry from due to proper management and documentation of record, effluent discharge, effluent monitoring, air quality monitoring. Like for facilities which do not comply to the environmental and social standards, we do not manage that environmental aspect of their project, we see that such facilities tend to pollute the environment even without knowing. They tend to pollute the water stream, they pollute the air, contaminate the soil, and this impacts directly and indirectly the lives of the host community. The project affected parties are being impacted, and then sometimes these kind of things lead to litigation. You see, where the company sues the community, sues the company to court, and then due to lack of maintenance record, lack of environmental monitoring, that's environmental impact and mitigation, due to lack of so many things, environmental auditing, the facility operators are stranded in defense because there is actually no defense to be made because there is no proper monitoring and evaluation of the environment. But with the proper, with investment in the environmental management, the operator stands to benefit, not only to win cases in the court, but not to even arrive at the court in the first place. It helps them to manage the environment effectively, and they coexist with the society seamlessly. And the next one we see again is minimization of project operation downtime.
minimization of project operation downtime. Many projects are truncated due to poor environmental management. For instance, for a diesel storage section of a facility or fuel storage section of a facility, if the place is kept clean, leakages are quickly noticed. If the place is clean, the leakages will be quickly noticed, and then everything that is needed can be quickly done. But if there is no such management in place, the whole tank of containing the fuel that upon which the facility is supposed to operate can be depleted, and the operations are not even aware until they have a downtime, or probably due to poor management in a mine site, like in the aspect of reclamation. If there is a poor reclamation plan, site reclamation plan in place, we see that even the equipment can fall into traps due to mines pits, underground pits. They could just break into it, and there could be lots of accidents. And then facilities can sink down in the mine site due to poor management of the mine site. So this also minimizes the operation downtime of the facility. And to summarize it all, with the above mentioned and the ones which are not yet mentioned, everything, investment in environmental management provides cost benefits. It gives a large cost benefit advantages. Like in many areas, when the facility is properly managed, it is better to put signage in facilities. And it's better to monitor effluent. It's better to monitor the air quality, because the response plan of lack of monitoring is more costly than the cost of mitigation. The cost of abatement at source is more cheaper than the one that we try to mitigate at receptor. For instance, if an effluent, maybe a facility that discharges effluent, refuses to monitor its effluent, when it discharges into the water stream and then it gets into the community and harms the community members and harms the society, we see that the cost now is going to be very high, because they are, apart from the social violence that they might induce for themselves, they will be forced to make some kind of financial commitments which they are not prepared for. And also, an investment in the community development agreement. When a project invests in community development agreement, which is part of the social sustainability aspect, when it invests in that area, we see that there are less, the community members, the society are seeing direct benefit they are deriving from the operation of this facility. So it aids them, it helps them to see it on a different light. But if these benefits are not accrued to them, if they don't see this benefit, they don't see these advantages, it can spur up so many things. It can give in so many violence actions and so many misunderstandings. So everything we have said here, we see that it is even more profitable and more beneficial to manage the environment effectively than to mismanage the environment and begin to do emergency plans to what the organization or what the operator has not budgeted for. So with this, I come to the conclusion of the brief course on the investment on environmental sustainability. Investment in environmental sustainability for cooperation. Thank you very much for listening, and thank you for your time. So